పూజంతం రామ రామేతి మధురం మధురాక్షరం ఆరుహ్య కవితా శాఖాం వందే వాల్మీకి కోకిలం యత్ర యత్ర రఘునాథ కీర్తనం తత్ర తత్ర కృతమస్తకాంజలిం బాష్పవారి పరిపూర్ణలోచనం మారుతిం నమత రాక్షసాంతకం వైదేహీ సహితం సురద్రుమతలే హైమే మహామంటపే మధ్యే పుష్పకమాసనే మణిమయే వీరాసనే సుస్థితం అగ్రే వాచయతి ప్రభంజనసుతే తత్వం మునిభ్యః పరం వ్యాఖ్యాంతం భరతాదిభిః పరివృతం రామం భజే శ్యామలం. ద రామాయణ సిరీస్ పార్ట్ 31. The search begins. Rama found a friend in Sugriva, and the friends Rama and Sugriva decided to wipe off each other's sorrows. And as the first move, Rama freed Sugriva from the shackles of fear that he had from his brother Vali. And he restored back the kingdom of Kishkindha to Sugriva and got him coronated. Now it was the turn of Sugriva to do his duty towards his friend Rama. It was his duty to now help Rama search for Sita. An event which was very encouraging to Rama when he met Sugriva was that the monkeys along with Sugriva already had some clue about Sita's abduction. It so happened that when Sugriva and Rama met for the first time and Rama told him how his wife had been kidnapped by Ravana, Sugriva told him that one day when some of his follower monkeys were standing under a tree, they saw a divine woman being carried away by an ogre, and she threw a bundle of jewels down which was caught by these monkeys, and that bundle Sugriva had safely kept. He told his followers to immediately get that bundle, which they did, and Rama identified them to be Sita's jewels, and he asked Lakshmana, do you know, can you identify, these are your sister-in-law's jewels? At this time, Lakshmana very beautifully uttered a shloka. He said, Naham janami keyure, naham janami kundale, nupure twabhijanami, nityam padabhivandanat. I do not know her ear ornaments or her hand ornaments. All that I can identify in this lot of jewels is the anklet that was worn by Sita Devi, which I used to observe every day as I touched her feet to take her blessings. Such was the devotion that Lakshmana had towards Sita. He would unfailingly bow down to her and seek her blessings daily. So these ornaments of Sita had rightly fallen into the hands of these monkeys. We may recollect that this was narrated in that part of the heinous hermit, when we described how Sita was abducted by Ravana and how she dropped the jewels on the way. So those monkeys who collected the jewels were none other than Sugriva's kinsmen. And this itself seemed like a very positive signal to Rama. And now, after Vali was defeated and Sugriva was coronated, it was the time to pursue the search of Sita. They already had a clue that Sita had flown in the southern direction and that she had given her jewels down. So these monkeys also had a clue as to what to look for. But now, after Vali was assassinated, the season that set in was the rainy season. And in those days, it was tough to go searching for anybody in the rains. Even today it is tough. It was even more tough with less of technology in those days. So they decided to stall the search till the rainy season got over. They thought that once autumn set in, they would begin their search vigorously. Saying so, Sugriva retired back in his kingdom, happily enjoying all the pleasures that he was missing all these days. Rama did not even enter the city of Kishkindha, it is said, because he had given a vow to his father that he would not enter any city or village but live in the forest alone for 14 years. And so, he did not enter the city of Kishkindha. It was Lakshmana who went into the city of Kishkindha and spoke to Sugriva and saw his coronation and all that. Rama stayed in the outskirts of Kishkindha in the Prasravana mountain and waited for this rainy season to pass. It is said that Rama lamented every day like the clouds poured out rain. He would pour out his tears, missing the company of Sita. It was a very sad plight to see for Lakshmana. And he was just waiting for autumn to set in. And autumn actually set in. And the beautiful full moon came out. And nice blossoms were coming around. But Sugriva had apparently completely forgotten about his duty towards his friend. Because he had been enjoying these royal pleasures after a long time. So, in that intoxication, he completely forgot his duty. He was gently reminded by Hanuman, it seems, that he had some moral responsibility towards his dear friend Rama. And immediately Sugriva agreed and said that he would get the troops ready to go in search of Sita. At this very time, Lakshmana got quite angry with Sugriva. Looking at his brother's plight and looking at the indifference of Sugriva, he got very annoyed with him. And it seems he came with great anger to the palace of Kishkindha and stood outside and twanged his bow, saying that, what is happening here? How can somebody give up his gratitude towards his friend and completely behave indifferent, forgetting his duty? Sugriva by now had already realized his folly because of Hanuman's wise words. So, it is said that he sent Vali's wife Tara as a messenger to Lakshmana to pacify him, saying that he was really sorry for the delay and that he would really take up the responsibility of searching very, very seriously from that moment. Listening to these consoling words of Tara, Lakshmana felt reassured. And it is said that he went and then met Sugriva so calmly and so willingly that it never seemed that there was so much anger in Lakshmana or so much indifference in Sugriva before. Purvacharyas describe this union of Lakshmana and Sugriva after some difference of opinion as the bond of unbreaking glue. Vajralepa ghatita manar pol purundi poravum praptam, they say. It's something like having a fevicol bond, we can say. This is the very characteristic swarupa of devotees of the Lord, Bhagavatas. Even if they have some difference of opinion amongst themselves, they resolve it very soon. And when they come back with complete love and affection. Like it happened in the case of Lakshmana and Sugriva. And now very willingly, Sugriva started collecting all the monkey forces for the sake of searching Sita. He said that he dispatched monkey forces in all the four directions with orders that they must come back and report within a month's time with positive news. So in the northern direction, he sent Shatabali, the monkey, and a lot of troops with him. Western quarter, he sent Sushena the monkey and some more troops with him. In the eastern quarter, he sent Vinata the monkey along with some troops. And to the south, he dispatched Hanuman, Angada, Jambavan and many more monkeys for search. Now, they had hope of finding Sita more in the southern direction. because everybody had given indications towards the south only, be it Jatayu, be it Kabanda, or be it these monkeys who received that packet of jewels from Sita. So they all expected to find Sita more in the southern direction. So it is said that Rama handed over his signet ring to Hanuman and said that, please give this to Sita as an identification mark when you find her, so that she recognizes you as my messenger. This is a logical move to be giving his signet ring to somebody going in the southern direction. But more than the logical aspect of it was the trust of Rama and Hanuman which made him hand over his signet ring to Hanuman alone and not anyone else. Rama had the intuition that Hanuman would find Sita, and that's the reason why he sent his identification mark with Hanuman alone. All the monkey troops set out in all the four directions, and it is said that monkeys from the northwest and east returned back within a month's time without any positive news. They couldn't find Sita in those directions. The troop which went southwards found it very difficult to search through the Vindhya range during this autumn season. Somehow they could not easily traverse those mountain paths, and so they were already delayed without covering the entire distance of the south in this land of Bharata. So they were a little worried. They were thinking that we have already run out of time and winter is about to set in. A month's time is already over. So how do we get back to Sugriva? We don't have any good news in hand and we are late also. So what do we do? And they were all hungry and tired searching, it seems. At this time, they suddenly found a very enchanting cave called as Rikshabila. They just entered it out of curiosity and they found that this cave had all possible kinds of eatables and fruits and vegetables, and it was also studded with stones and it really looked like another heaven. And a heavenly lady named Swayam Prabha came out of that cave and very hospitably entertained these monkeys, giving them food and rest for a while. After having this, the monkeys really felt relaxed and more encouraged to search further. As they went to the edge of the cave, the other end of the cave, they found themselves towards the end of the mountains, and the ocean was somewhere quite nearby. At this point of time, they thought, now we have almost reached the end of the land and we don't have any news and we don't know what to do. And again, we are still getting more and more late every day. So do we actually go back or do we fast unto death? Angada, Vali's son, promoted that it's better that we fast unto death instead of going back and getting the wrath of Sugriva. It's better we stay back here. There was another monkey called Tara who said, let's go back to this Rikshabila and live there only. Let's not go back to Kishkindha at all. But Hanuman, the righteous one, said, whatever said and done, we have to report back to our king whether the errand is completed or not. So it would not be wise to do either of these things. That is, give up our lives or go back to Rikshabila. So let us do what is righteous. This was promoted by Hanuman. The monkeys were all confused and they started lamenting out. They said, why are we in this position at all? It's only because our king has dispatched us here. And he has dispatched us here because Rama became his friend. And Rama needed this help of our king only because he happened to be searching for his wife. His wife got lost. And even if she got lost, he could have got whereabouts of his wife from that Jatayu at least. Jatayu actually sacrificed his life for the sake of Sita. Had he told where Sita was exactly, we could have at least found out. Or even better, if he could have saved Sita himself, all this plight would have never befallen us. Like this, they started lamenting in many ways. And when they mentioned the name of Jatayu, another big eagle came and stood near them. The monkeys were terrified. This big eagle was there for some time listening to these monkeys. He was observing as these monkeys came out of that cave and he was thinking he was going to get a great meal today. But he found it interesting to listen to these monkeys, so he was listening for a while. But as soon as he heard the name Jatayu, he came near these monkeys and asked, "Jatayu, did you say Jatayu?" The monkeys were all terrified. They said, "Yes." At this time, the eagle revealed that Jatayu is my brother. Did you say he's no more? The monkeys sadly said, "Yes." Then the eagle revealed his identity and said he was none other than the elder brother of Jatayu named Sampati. And he was living there on these mountain tops and he would just pick up any prey that would come by and satisfy his hunger and stay. He did not have wings to fly because his wings had got burnt once when they soared up high up to the sun. It seems Sampati and Jatayu, when they were young, they wanted to test their powers of flying high. So they flew high near the sun. And it was a situation such that their wings were about to get burnt. So in order to protect Jatayu's wings from getting burnt, Sampati went and covered his wings. And because of that, he lost his own wings. And he got dropped onto these mountains from when he had been living on these mountains only. So Sampati told them his story. And he was really sad to know about the fate of his brother Jatayu. And he performed his last rites. He gave sacramental water for his departed brother. And then he had some useful information to give to these monkeys. He said, "You all are talking about searching for Rama's wife Sita, who was carried away by Ravana. I saw him carrying away Sita. They flew past this part only. And I have been blessed with long sight. I can see very, very far. Now I can see and tell you that Sita is there across the ocean, 100 miles away from here, 100 yojanas away from here. So if one can take a leap of 100 yojanas and go across the ocean, you're sure to find Sita. She's there across the ocean." And this was promising news to the monkeys. They were so happy that their search had finally started yielding result. So with this happiness in mind, they were all ready to now go in search of Sita. But who could actually leap 100 yojanas? There came this question now. And the monkeys started pondering over this issue. What came up as a solution, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurnalochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpaka Masane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjana Sute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakshantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 32, Obstacles Overcome with Optimism. That's the title of today. We saw that the monkey forces were channelized into the search of Sita, and the troop of monkeys who traveled towards the south to search for Sita landed in a place near the ocean where they met Jatayu's elder brother Sampati, who told them that Sita was there 100 yojanas away. If one could cross the sea and go to Lanka, that's where she was kept. Listening to this news, the monkeys all got excited and they now knew that they were definitely going to get positive results for their search. But now the question was, how would they cross these 100 yojanas? Did the monkeys have the capacity to leap across such a huge distance? Could they fly that distance and get to the other side of the ocean? They started thinking, and some monkeys said they could cover a distance of 10 yojanas, some said they could do 30, some said 50, and some said 90. But whether it was 10 or whether it was 90, if they had to jump only those many yojanas, less than 100, they would fall into the sea. Because the distance of the sea to its other shore here was 100 yojanas. So whether you fall at the distance of 10 yojanas or 90 yojanas doesn't matter. But one would fall into the sea if he tries to cross. So then everybody were wondering what to do. And this juncture where the monkeys were thinking as to who would cross the sea marks the end of the Kishkindha Kanda. That is the fourth unit of the Ramayana. This fourth unit, the Kishkindha Kanda, began when Rama and Hanuman met at the Pampa Lake. The Aranya Kanda got over with Shabari Moksha, and after that the Kishkindha Kanda started, which ends with the pondering of monkeys as to how to cross the ocean. After this begins the fifth Kanda, the very beautiful Kanda called the Sundara Kanda. And in this, the Kanda commences with the motivation of Hanuman to cross the ocean. When the monkeys were all thinking as to who will cross the ocean, Jambavan, the old wise bear who was always with the monkey forces, had a story to tell. He told Hanuman that, "Oh Hanuman, you have great powers with you which you are not aware of. As a child, you went and tried to eat up the sun thinking that it was a fruit. And because of that, Indradeva got angry with you and hit you on your chin. And from then on, you came to be known as Hanuman, the one with a hit chin. When Indradeva hit you with his vajra and you fell down, your father Vayu was very disturbed. And he said he would no more go around the worlds and give air to everybody. So the Devas were all very scared and they decided to please Vayu by giving you a lot of boons. And in that process, you received many boons from many Devas. You received the boon of longevity, of living in this earth as long as you want to. You received the boon of being able to transform your form into small or big as you wish. You receive the boon of fire not scorching you, and you receive the boon of leaping great distances. Thus, you are empowered with so many boons." Then Hanuman said, "You're talking about my childhood, but I don't seem to remember anything of this sort." To this, Jambavan replied that, "Yes, you were cursed by sages not to remember all this until somebody reminded you of these strengths. Because having got these strengths, you were very playful as a child and your pranks created hindrance for sages. So they cursed you, they gave you a mild curse saying that you'll forget about all such special powers that you have till somebody reminds you of it. And today here I am reminding you of it. Oh Hanuman, you have the capability to leap across the ocean. So rise and fly and go and find Mother Sita." So saying, Jambavan motivated Hanuman, and Hanuman took flight from the Mahindra mountain like Garuda, it seems. உத்பபாதாத வேகேன வேகவான் அவிசாரயன் சுபர்ணமிவசாத்மானம் மேனே ச கபிகுஞ்சரா. He went flying like Suparna, that is Garuda, in an unimaginable speed. Now as Hanuman was crossing the ocean, he met three obstacles on the way. First, it is said that the mountain named Mainaka appeared in front of him from the sea. It is said that once upon a time, mountains had wings and Indra cut off the wings of all mountains. At that time, this particular mountain Mainaka went and hid in the ocean with the help of Vayudeva. And now when the son of Vayu was coming along, the mountain wanted to offer hospitality to him. But Hanuman had no time for hospitality. But it would be rude to not accept the hospitality that the mountain was giving. So, just to pay respect to that hospitality and yet not waste time, Hanuman very beautifully handled this. And he went around the Mainaka mountain. He circumambulated it as a mark of respect. Just touched all the wonderful items given by the mountain and went on his way flying without wasting any time. The next obstacle that Hanuman found was the goddess of Nagas named as Surasa Devi. She was sent by the Devas to test the conviction that Hanuman had to his purpose. So this Surasa Devi opened her mouth like a cave. And she told Hanuman that anybody who crosses this way has to enter my mouth. That's a rule. So you tell me what you're going to do. Are you going to enter my mouth and become food for me? Or are you going to pass by me and incur my wrath? Hanuman said, see, if it is a norm that anybody who passes this way enters your mouth, then I have to enter. But if somebody comes out of your mouth without getting harmed, then it is okay, right? Hanuman asked very intelligently. She said, of course, if you can go into my mouth and come out, I am not going to do anything to you. I am not going to offer combat to you, fight and eat you up. That's not my habit. I just open my mouth. Anything that comes in, comes in. Anything that goes out, goes out. So as they were talking like this, Hanuman immediately shrunk himself. Because he had this boon of having the quality of anima, that is becoming small. So he immediately entered the mouth of Surasa Devi and came out in no time. Before even Surasa Devi could understand what happened, Hanuman did this. And very intelligently overcame this obstacle too. The Devas were very happy that Hanuman was steadfast in his purpose and they blessed him and he went further. The third obstacle that came was in the form of an ogress named Simhika. She meant honest trouble to Hanuman. She wanted to fight with him and she wanted to eat him up really. So Hanuman offered fight to her. And it is said that he went into the mouth of Simhika and came out piercing her tummy. He could have well done this with Surasa Devi too. But he chose not to because he knew it was just test that was given by Surasa Devi. But here Simhika meant offense to him and she was real evil which had to be warded off. Thus, with his patience, with his intelligence and with his valor, Hanuman overcame all the three obstacles that stood by his way as he crossed the ocean. He had steadfastness of purpose. He knew that somehow, come what may, he had to fly across the ocean and find Mother Sita. So all these obstacles were only stepping stones for him to move on. And he did not unnecessarily waste time when it could be done away with without having a combat. But when a combat was necessary, like crushing the ego of the Simhika, he did get into that combat and gave that time too for the same. With overcoming of these obstacles, Hanuman crossed the ocean and landed in the city of Lanka. It is said that the city of Lanka was guarded by
the guarding goddess called Lankini. And Hanuman hit her with his left fist when she tried to stop him and prevent him from entering Lanka. And Lankini remembered the prophecy of Brahmadeva. He had told her that the day a monkey comes and hits you would be the day of doom for Lanka. So she knew that Lanka was in trouble now. And Hanuman entered the city of Lanka full of hope to find Mother Sita. Hanuman waited till it was night time, made himself small in size so that he could fly through the city very easily, unnoticed, and look for Sita. It is said that Hanuman looked into every street of Lanka, every house of Lanka, and at each and every woman, thinking that she would be Sita. Hanuman was a brahmachari, so he somehow felt a little guilty that he was looking at women like this. But then he consoled himself, saying that he had the right intention and a lust-free mind, and thus he eased out his conscience. Then he caught sight of Ravana reposing on an excellent couch decked with various ornaments, adorned with jewelry of every description. And somewhere nearby, he found a lady who was graced with bright jewels asleep. That was Mandodari, the wife of Ravana. For once, Hanuman thought that he had found Sita, and he got encaptured in this thought and exhibited his joy through various monkey gestures like kissing the end of his tail. But then immediately sense came back to him. He said, "No way, this can never be Sita. How could Sita be lying happily like this in the absence of Rama?" Moreover, it is said that Hanuman knew Samudrika Shastra. That is, looking at the face of a person, Hanuman could predict future. And looking at the face of this lady, Mandodari, lying down here, he could predict that her husband was to be gone very shortly. And looking at the face of Rama, he had predicted a long life for Rama, knowing Samudrika Shastra. So he knew that this was a mismatch, and anyways, how could it be possible that Sita would accept all these royal pleasures in the absence of Rama? So banishing this thought from his head, he again started looking for Sita more vigorously. Having failed to discover Sita even after searching for her in so many places, Hanuman ends up suspecting many things. Srinidhi Swami says, Chintam bahuvidham beje hanta dihridayam param rakshita naivasa bala bhakshita rakshasa punaha patita sagare kimsa patitankat bhayakula nishantam akhilam drishtva nishantam prapyamarutihi. Hanuman got worried. Instead of saving Sita and letting her accept him, Ravana maybe got angry with Sita so much that he ate her off. Or while coming to Lanka, did Sita get dropped into the ocean? Did she fall down into the ocean? Or did she fall unconscious in the place that where Ravana had kept her, and the ogresses thought she was dead and they actually ate her away? What all could have happened to Sita? What on earth could have happened to her? Thinking thus, Hanuman was really troubled in his mind. For a moment, he thought, was it even worth existing that he came all the way till his destination and now he was not able to find it? He came all the way to Lanka looking for Sita with complete hope, and now he was feeling so dejected and frustrated. But then optimism dawned upon him and he said, "No. Rama has given me his signet ring, having so much trust on me. So he must be knowing best. He would have thought that I would find Sita, and I will find her." When he was trying to cope up with his mental condition like this and giving optimism to his own self, he suddenly found a grove which he had not visited yet. This was the Ashoka grove in which Sita was actually kept. Thus, overcoming all obstacles with optimism, Hanuman finally identified the grove in which Sita was. And how he went and met Sita in that grove, we shall see in the next part.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpaka Masade Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakshantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 33. Ramayana, the savior of Sita. That's the title of today. Hanuman was reminded about his strength by Jambavan, and after this he crossed the ocean and reached Lanka in search of Sita Devi. He searched the entire city thoroughly, through all streets, the markets, houses, villages, and even the palace. But Sita was nowhere to be found. Hanuman was upset with this and started thinking what to do when he caught sight of a beautiful grove which he had not checked before. So with great hope, he went into that grove. This was the Ashoka grove in which Sita was actually present. He saw Sita there, and the moment he saw her, the first thought that struck him was, oh my God, such a divine lady. How is Rama even able to survive without her all these days? It is said that Hanuman always used to think, why is Rama wailing so much? Because he is away from his wife. Hanuman couldn't comprehend because he was a brahmachari, and he really couldn't understand the plight of Rama. But today, after looking at Sita, he felt that it is really surprising that one can even survive in the absence of a spouse like Sita. She's so divine, he thought. But Sita's plight was really sad. She had her hair all disheveled, all her garments in a pathetic, dirty state, and she really looked miserable. Srinidhi Swami says, Bahunyastamukhi Venya Rahugraste Duratravat Ushnamashru Pramunchanti Ushnam Sudrashadam Yatha. It seems her hair covered her face. This was like the moon being covered by the serpent Rahu. Sita's face was like a moon, and her braid was like a serpent, and it covered her face all over, and it looked like her entire moon-like face was eclipsed by Rahu. And she shed hot tears. Ushnamashru, it is said. And how were these hot tears? How hot were they? They were as hot as hot water coming out from the Suryakanta stone when the sun's rays fall on it. It is said that when the sun's rays fall on this particular stone called Suryakanta, steaming hot water comes out from it. Similarly, Sita's tears were so hot. One sheds hot tears when one is in trouble. Cool tears come when they are tears of joy. So here, Sita was shedding hot tears because of her separation pangs, and she was in this state when Ravana suddenly entered. All this Hanuman was watching, sitting on a shimshupa tree which was nearby, but he wanted to avoid being seen by others, so he hid and saw what was happening. Ravana walked in after getting up from his intoxication, and he came to lure Sita to his way. This was a routine, And today he came to do it, which was witnessed by Hanuman. He told her many things to somehow pacify her to become his wife. Sita placed a blade of grass between herself and Ravana in order to avoid direct contact with this augur of evil intentions. And she tried to show him the right path. She told him, "Please withdraw your minds from me and let it be satisfied with your own concerts. Being the virtuous wife of another, I cannot be your lawful consort. Please take into account the rule of conduct of virtuousness and follow your duty. Please try to follow the path of righteousness. Do not lust for me. And you know something? You have today abducted me and got me here. So my master Rama would be really angry with you. But he's a very compassionate person. If you go and surrender to him, he will definitely not do anything to you. You make friendship with him." Initially, she said, Rama is the one who is very pleased with surrender. And then she says, you make friends with him. She says, "Viditasahi dharmajnaha sharanagata vatsalaha tena maitri bhavatu te yadi jivitum icchasi." If your life is dear to you, you make friendship with him. Though she told him to make friendship with Rama, she actually wanted him to surrender to Rama, because just before that she had said, Rama is sharanagata vatsala, the one who is pleased with surrender. So she indicatively told Ravana to surrender to Rama so that he would be saved. She just wanted everybody to be saved and nobody to be slain. This is what we saw in the Aranyakanda also. When the sages did Sharanagati or surrender, Sita held the same view. She never wanted anybody to be in trouble. Even though Ravana was tormenting her so much, she only had compassion for him and tried to give him an option for saving himself. But the evil Ravana wouldn't listen. He took all of Sita's advice as threats for him, and he got angrier and told all the ogresses present nearby that you have to do your level best to pacify Sita to become my spouse, and I'm just giving her a time of a single month. If within this month she does not make up her mind in my favor, then just finish her off. Before that, you try your level best to get her into my way. Saying so, he angrily left the Ashoka group, and all the Rakshasis surrounded Sita and started frightening her. They were all so terrible to even look at. They had bloodshot eyes. Some had cat-like eyes, some had wolf-like eyes, and some of them had horns, and some of them had horrendous nails. They were all so scary, each one of them looking terrible and speaking absolutely unethical words. Sita couldn't just bear the sight and talk, and they all tried to scare her in different ways. All that also was still bearable by Sita. What she could not really bear was, they kept saying, you have to accept Ravana for your husband. And this really, really put Sita into deep despair. She was feeling so helpless. But at this time, suddenly, an ogress named Trijata, who was the daughter of Ravana's brother Vibhishana, came and drove away all the other Rakshasis away from Sita. She said, you dare not scare Sita or say a wrong word to her. I just had a dream, and in that dream I saw Rama come and gain victory over Ravana. We were all defeated at the hands of Rama, and Sita is going to be triumphant at the end. So you people dare not say anything to Sita. Saying so, she drove away all the Rakshasis and comforted Sita. Sita did feel a little better. After a while, Trijata too went away, and Sita started thinking about how things have proceeded, and she was really feeling dejected that Rama hadn't still turned up to redeem her from this plight. And frustration got so much into herself that she wanted to end this life right at that moment. She decided to make a noose out of the strings used to tie her hair, and she thought of ending her life. Hanuman was watching all this from atop the Shimshupa tree, and then he felt this is the time of action. He had to somehow prevent this disaster. And what could save Sita now? Sita herself was in such deep trouble. Hanuman thought, he thought of jumping in front of her, and then he thought, if I jump suddenly, Sita may just shout, because she would never trust that anybody came to help her here. She would think it is another plan of Ravana to scare her. And I will also get seen by these ogresses, and then I'll not be able to talk to Sita. So I must not do that. Then, witty that he was, and having great presence of mind, he decided to sing the eternal elixir Ramayana. He decided to sing the Ramayana as a song so that listening to it would comfort Sita Devi and she would change her decision. So he started singing the Ramayana. Raja Dasharatho Nama Ratha Kunjara Vajiman. He started from the story of Dasharatha, how he came from the Ikshvaku race till he was there, till the point where Hanuman had reached the Ashoka Grove. He narrated the entire Ramayana. It seems Hanuman sang this Ramayana in the mother tongue of Sita, in the language of Mithila, it is said, so that she could identify that somebody close to her, somebody who knew her, somebody who wished well for her was singing the Ramayana. And he sang it in such a melodious and soft tone that it was heard only by Sita, and all these ogresses intoxicated with wine could not get to hear the Ramayana at all. Had they heard it that day, even they would have been saved. But as for now, Sita heard the Ramayana and she was overjoyed and wanted to know who was singing the Ramayana. She looked here and there and spotted Hanuman, who jumped down the tree now, knowing that Sita would not be scared. And then he introduced himself as the messenger of Rama and the minister of Sugriva, and having come there in search of Sita Devi. Sita was really overjoyed, but again, when Hanuman wanted to touch her feet, she had her own doubts. When he came near her, she felt maybe it was Ravana disguised as a monkey. So she got scared, but again, Hanuman reassured her that, no, I am a messenger of your own Lord Rama, and I can prove that I am his messenger. How he proved that he was a messenger will come in the next part. As for now, this episode of the Ashoka Vana is a very moving one. The way Sita was and the way she refused to accept the proposal of Ravana and still tried to do good to the one who was tormenting her so much, and the way the utterance of the Ramayana saved her is all really, really touching. So, narrating this Ashoka Vana episode actually brought tears into the eyes of people, says Srinidhi Swami. Not just that, it was also the cause of beautiful poetry coming out from the heart of Valmiki. And it is also a phase when Rama and Sita both were in great distress. So, all these four aspects have been very beautifully constructed into a shloka by Srinidhi Swami. He has used the word Ashoka Vanam in the first quarter of the shloka, where he says Sita was at Ashoka Vanam. Sita Ashokavanam Bheje. And because Sita was in Ashokavanam, Rama was in a forest of sorrow. He was overcome with sorrow. Rama Shokavanam Tataha. So Rama was in Shokavana. Sita was in Ashokavanam and Rama was in Shokavanam. So in the second quarter, he has taken out the first letter from the word Ashokavanam and made it Shokavanam. Next, in the third quarter, the poet says that because of this episode happening, the sage Valmiki composed the beautiful Sundarakanda. So, he got poetic skills. He got Kavanam. Kavanam is the ability to make poetry, Kavita. Valmiki Kavanam Tatra. That's the third quarter. So, now, from Shokavanam, the letter Sho is removed and Kavanam remains. That is a part of the third quarter. So, in the first quarter, the word Ashokavanam was mentioned when it was said that Sita was in Ashokavanam. In the second quarter, the word Shokavanam was mentioned, indicating that Rama was in Shokavanam. And in the third quarter, the word Kavanam is mentioned, where it is said that Valmiki got the ability to make beautiful poetry, that is Kavanam. And then in the fourth quarter, he says, anybody who listens to this story cannot but help getting emotional. He will have tears in his eyes. And tears is also called vanam in Sanskrit. So, everybody's eyes would have tears on listening to this story. Sarva chakshustato vanam. So, now what happened? From the word kavanam, the letter ka is removed and only vanam remains in the fourth quarter. So, subsequently, the first letter is removed from the word Ashokavanam in each of these quarters, and the shloka is beautifully constructed to convey the meaning that the episode of Ashokavanam is such a moving one. So the first quarter has Ashokavanam, where it is said that Sita was in Ashokavanam. The second quarter has the word Shokavanam, where it is said that Rama went to Shokavanam. And the third quarter has the word Kavanam, where it is said that sage Valmiki got the ability to make beautiful poetry, that is Kavanam. And the fourth quarter says, listening to the story, everybody would have Vanam in their eyes, that is tears in their eyes. Such a moving story the Sundarakandam is. Thus, in this Sundarakandam, in this episode of Rama meeting Sita and the Ashokavana, we got to understand that even for Sita Devi herself, who is the mother of the universe, the Ramayana was the elixir. It was the savior. She heard the Ramayana and sustained. Ramayana was the reason why Sita Devi did not resort to the dreadful end that she had thought of. So the Ramayana actually saved Sita today. And this beautiful Ramayana came out from the pious mouth of Hanuman, who is himself so devoted to the Ramayana. Once Sita heard everything from Hanuman, she just wanted confirmation that Hanuman was indeed the spy of Rama. And to give this confirmation, Hanuman narrated an episode which was told by Rama to him to be told to Sita. What that episode was, we shall see in the next part.